So today's topic is minimization of potential energy and how to use this principle to compute the finite element equations. That means to find out the stiffness matrix and the force vector. So here this is the potential energy. And the potential energy is defined in terms of U, that is the displacement. So generally we denote this potential energy by capital Pi, and the potential energy is defined as strain energy minus potential of loads. And this potential of loads is nothing but applied forces multiplied by displacement in the directions of those applied forces. So in some books this is called work potential, and you know strain energy means half epsilon transpose sigma dv, where dv is the volume. So dv is actually, so this integration is over the total volume. And you know what is epsilon? Epsilon has 6 components. Now 3 normal stresses, 3 normal strains and 3 shear strains. And this sigma has got again 6 components, 3 normal stresses and 3 shear stresses. So we define potential energy like this. Now we will go through a few examples to understand how to find out this potential energy expression. So suppose you take the case of a spring. Take the case of the spring. Okay, you suppose there is one load P here and another load Q here. So one load P here and another load Q here. So the displacement at this degree of freedom is U1 and at this degree of freedom is U2. So what is the strain energy stored in this spring? This is half K1 into U1 square, because at this end displacement is 0. So the extension of this spring is U1. And if we assume U2 is greater than U1, then the strain energy stored in this is half K2 U2 minus U1 square. So this is the strain energy, and it is in terms of displacement, not a continuous displacement function but some discrete displacements at some specific degrees of freedom. So now if you write it in matrix notation, so if you expand this, this is this, and if you write it in matrix form, this will be something like this. You can just multiply this and you can check. So U1, oh here there will be transpose. So I missed the transpose notation here, transpose symbol here. So this is transpose. So if you multiply, then this is K1 plus K2 into U1, and this is minus K2 into U1. And when it goes through this, so this is K1 plus K2 into U1 square. This is K1 plus K2 U1 square minus K2 U1 U2. So you can just multiply and check whether you are getting this expression or not. So this is the actually the strain energy for these two springs. Now if you notice carefully, this is nothing but the, this matrix is nothing but the stiffness matrix of the system when you eliminate the left end boundary degree of freedom, left end boundary degree of freedom which has got zero displacement. So if you eliminate the boundary condition, then this is the stiffness matrix. So, and potential of load means simply load into displacement. So here the potential of load is P into U1 plus Q into Q2. So The potential energy expression is, this is the first part, is the strain energy, and this is the strain energy part, and this is the potential of load part. So now let us go to a continuous system. The previous system was a discrete system. So this is a continuous system. This is a bar which can only extend in the axial direction. They extend or get compressed in the axial direction. So at any distance x from the left end of the bar, let the displacement be Qx. L is the length of the bar and UL is the displacement at x equal to L. So UL is the displacement at x equal to L. So here there is a single strain component, that is the normal strain in this direction. So this is du dx. You already know this. And stress is E into strain. Stress is E into strain, where E is the Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity. So stress is E into du dx. And strain energy is half sigma into epsilon dv. In place of dv, here we put adx, where A is the cross section, where A is the cross section and E is the modulus of rigidity. So A and E are the cross sections and are the cross section and modulus of rigidity respectively. So nice. So now this is the strain energy and the potential energy will be like this. So it is in terms, this is in U, so it is in also in terms of U, and this is the potential energy. Now if we consider a beam, this is a beam, this is a beam, a thin beam, and if you cut a section between, say here it is x, say this is x, from here to here this is x, this is x, and this is tx, this is dx, and you show it here. So this is the bent shape of the beam. So here we take sagging bending moment positive m here, and here it is m plus dm. Here dw theta is the slope, theta is dw dx for small dw, and small, and the slope is also small, and this is theta plus d theta. So here you know m equal to ei d2w dx2. Maybe in Timoshenko's book you got a negative sign here, but here we are getting positive sign because see dw dx is here and dw dx here is in, so dw dx is increasing from here to here. That means d2w dx2 is positive. So this d2w dx2 is positive here because dw dx is increasing with x, and that happens for a positive bending moment if you consider the sagging bending moment to be positive. So this is m equal to ei d2w dx2. That means if you consider a sagging bending moment to be a positive, d2w dx2 is also positive. So this is the relation. Now strain energy will be half m, and the rotation it is creating, so half m into d theta. So half m into d theta is the strain energy. Half m into d theta, just like force into displacement, it is moment into change in slope or moment into rotation. So this is half m d theta dx dx, where x is integrated with from 0 to L. So m in place of m we are putting ei d2w dx2, and since theta is dw dx, dt dx again d2w dx2. So this is the expression for strain energy. So you may ask that why you are considering m into d theta as strain energy, because m has changed to m plus dm here, but dm into d theta will give you a second order term and can be neglected from the expression. And what is the potential of load, it is here the load is distributed, so it should be Q. So here suppose the displacement here is W, displacement here is W, so Q into W integrated over the whole length. But Q we are considering downward positive and W we are considering upward positive, so in place of minus it has become plus. So this is plus. Okay. Had we considered this Q also to be positive in the upward direction, Q also to be positive in the upward direction, then it would be minus QW dx. So distributed load taken in the negative y direction, distributed load taken in the negative y direction. That's why this plus is coming. Now what is the principle of minimization of potential energy? What is the principle of minimization of potential energy? So this is the principle of minimization of potential energy. And what is this principle of minimization of potential energy? Suppose for a problem like this, you have U versus X. So this is the solution. This blue one is the solution. This blue line is the solution. Now you give a small variation to the solution. So del U is also a function of X, and that is an admissible variation, otherwise arbitrary, about the actual solution. So del U X is an admissible arbitrary variation about the actual solution. So in place of this pink one, you can also take this as the varied path, no problem, but it has to be admissible. What do you mean by admissible? Admissible means it satisfies the, that means the actual solution satisfies, oh sorry, that means the variation satisfies the essential boundary condition. That means where essential boundary condition is prescribed, you cannot give any variation. Because suppose here U is specified, so the variation should be zero. So you cannot violate the essential boundary condition, and you have to have sufficient continuity conditions. So that is called admissible variation. Now due to this, now suppose in place of U, you are considering U plus del U as your solution. So what is the corresponding change in pi? This pi U plus del U minus pi U. So this we call del pi, or the variation in pi. That means the variation, the difference between the, when you take U plus del U as the solution and when you take U as the solution. Now minimization of potential energy says that if U is the solution, then this variation in pi would be zero. That means, and this is also called the potential energy is stationary. This, that means for U to be the actual solution, you do not know U. But if this U has to be the actual solution, the variation in pi due to small arbitrary admissible variation in U is zero. Okay, if U is the solution, you don't know the solution, but the solution is that, but the actual solution is that, the variation, actual solution is that, if you give a small arbitrary admissible variation to the actual solution, the corresponding variation in pi should be zero. So this is how you can get U. You do not know U, but you know that if U is the actual solution, then a small variation about U makes your potential energy stationary. So now we'll learn the Rayleigh-Ritz method. So, and for obviously for 1D problems, here we are not studying 2D problems or 3D problems. So write down the potential energy expression pi u. Now take a polynomial approximation for u. So you let u cap be an approximation for u, and let u cap be a polynomial and this polynomial is such that it satisfies the essential boundary condition. Now if you put this u cap in pi, then in place of pi u, you get pi u cap, and x will get integrated, and this will become a function of the undetermined or unknown coefficients, because these coefficients we do not know. We will determine these coefficients. So these we can say the undetermined coefficients. Now pi u cap becomes a function of the undetermined coefficients. Now that is the actual solution, as we know from minimization of potential energy, that is the actual solution about which, if we give a small variation, the variation in pi, here it is pi of u cap, is 0. So now what do you mean by giving a variation in the solution? Here we can give variation in this undetermined coefficients. So we can only change this coefficients, because we cannot change x. X is the independent variable and it gets integrated over length. So we cannot change x, only we can give small arbitrary variations to these coefficients. And if the change in pi due to the change in this arbitrary change in this coefficients is 0, then we can find out the actual solution. So what is change in pi? If we change these coefficients, then del pi equal to del pi cap, del a naught, del a naught, del pi del a1, del a1, del, and up to del pi del an, del an. So now these variations are arbitrary. That means it may be possible. Now this del pi cap is 0 for this solution to be the correct solution. So for del pi cap to be 0, all these terms have to be zeros independently. Why independently? Because these variations are arbitrary. That means suppose we can take only variation in a naught, and we can take the variation in other coefficients to be zeros. So that then del pi is only this term. So this term has to be 0 for your u cap to be the actual solution. So this term has to be 0. In this way, we can make del a1 non-zero and all other variations to be variations of the coefficients to be zeros. Then this term has to be 0. So these n conditions we are getting, and these n conditions will give you n simultaneous equations, and when you solve these n simultaneous equations, you get the values of these coefficients and you can find out the solution. So here is an example. This is a bar. This can only expand or get contracted in the axial direction, and here it is fixed, and here also it is fixed, and at 3/5 of its length, a constant force F is applied. So what is the displacement? What is the axial displacement pattern of this bar that we have to determine? So first of all, we have to write the potential energy expression. So this is the potential energy, this is the strain energy for the bar, and this is the potential of the load, F into U in at x equal to 3L by 5. Now you assume, a single term solution, a single coefficient solution. A1 is the single coefficient, and this is the polynomial term. Why polynomial term in this way, in this manner we have taken? Because at x equal to 0, u cap has to be 0, and x equal to L also, u cap have to be 0. So this satisfies the essential boundary conditions. Now you put this in this expression and integrate. So you get this as your pi cap, and del pi del a cap equal to 0 gives this, and in this way you find out your a1 value, and a1 is this. So your solution is this. Now if you take a two-term solution, a more accurate solution, then it is a1 into this and a2 into x square into l minus x. You could have also have taken a2x into l minus x square. So this is the next term we are taking, and we are using these two conditions. Now by using these two conditions we get two equations, and by solving those simultaneously those two equations, we get a1 a2 as this. So you will be this, u cap will be this. In this way we can use the Rayleigh-Ridge method. So using the potential minimization of potential energy principle, we will now derive the stiffness matrix of a bar element. Okay. So this is a bar element. So as you notice, this is a bar element, and in this bar element it has got 2 degrees of freedom. You can easily recollect this bar element from your memory, where we derived the stiffness matrix of bar element from first principles. So here we will be using the minimization of potential energy. So this is a bar, here u1 f1, u2 f2. This is called 2 degrees of freedom, and at a distance x from the left end, the displacement here, that is the axial displacement, is uex, that is the approximation, and ue stands for element. So u, the approximate displacement within the element. Now how do we find out the approximate expression for displacement within the element? We actually take it as a polynomial, just like Rayleigh-Ridge method. But here what we do, we put at x equal to 0, uv is equal to u1, so a0 is u1, and at x equal to l, which means at this point, uv equal to u2, so u2 equal to a0 plus a1l. So from these two equations, you get a1, a0 as u1, and a1 as u2 minus u1 by l. So here you write uv as u1 plus u2 minus u1 by lx, or rather this. So the undetermined coefficients are not the coefficients of the polynomials, but the undetermined coefficients are u1 and u2, which are the unknown displacements. So here u1 and u2, the undetermined or the unknown displacements, not the coefficients of, unknown coefficients of polynomial. We have written these two in terms of the unknown displacements. So we make a slight modification in the Rayleigh-Ridge method. Now u1 and u2 are the undetermined coefficients, and this we call n1 and this we call n2, and we call them shape functions. So ue, that means displacement at any point in the element, is interpolated. Displacement at any point x within the element is interpolated from the two end displacements u1 and u2. So you write uv equal to n1 u1 or n2 u2. So displacement at any point within the element is obtained by interpolating the displacement at the end degrees of freedom. So these n1 and n2 are called the interpolating functions, the interpolating functions or the shape functions. So n1 and n2 are called the shape functions. So now if you write the potential energy expression, it is this minus u1 f1 minus u2 f2. This is the potential of the load. Now what is ue? Ue is n1 u1 plus n2 u2. Or in matrix notation, n1 n2 a row matrix into u1 u2 a column matrix. So epsilon e, this is epsilon e, the first term is due dx is, so here this n1 and n2 are function of x, u1 and u2 are not functions of x, they are displacements at specified degrees of freedom. So this is dn1 dn2 dx, just see this dn1x dn2 dx into u1 u2. So this matrix we called the strain displacement matrix because it relates the displacement, it relates the strain to the, this is a strain term to the displacement. So this is generally denoted by B and is called the strain displacement matrix. So dUE is B, so dUE dx is BE. Now when it is multiplied with another dUE dx, what is done is this, the transpose of this is done and it is multiplied with this. So transpose of this multiplied by this, that is dUE dx dUE dx. So dUE, second dUE for the second dUE dx, we keep B into U1 U2 and the first one we just take the transpose of it. Okay. So here we have here written ADX inside the integral because this is dV. E we have written here. These are, E is a scalar quantity, so you can write it anywhere. So this is for 1 dUE dx. So first dUE dx has to be, we have to take the transpose of the first dUE dx, and this is the second dUE dx. ADX is again a scalar and it can be placed anywhere. So this is the potential energy expression in matrix notation. So for the first, this thing, it is U1 U2 transpose B transpose, and for this it is B into U1 U2. Since energy, strain energy is a scalar, so this has got 2 row 1 column, this is 1 row 2 column. So these two multiplied by, multiplied when you multiply, then it gives to, it gives you, so this is transpose, so 1 into 2, so it's not 2 into 1, actually 2 into 1, but you have taken transpose, so this is 1 into 2, and this is 2 into 1, because here we transpose 2 into 1, here it is 2 into 1, here it is 1 into 2, and here it is 2 into 1. So ultimately you get 1 into 2 into 2 into 1, that is 1 into 1, 1 into 1, 1 into 2, 1 into 2, 1 into 2, 2 into 1, 1 into 1. So a single term. So let me go back, and or you can just simply delete this because it will make the note clumsy. So let me delete it. Okay. Now it looks clear. Okay. So this also I remove. limit. Okay. So now if you take this u1, u2, because they do not depend on x, so this can be taken outside the integral and this u1, u2 can be taken outside the integral. So what remains inside the integral is this minus u1, u2 transpose f1, f2 is the potential of the loop. So see, notice that this itself is the stiffness matrix. Later on also we will notice. So now u1 and u2 are the unknown displacements and which can be given variation. So del pi cap del u1 should be 0 and del pi cap del u2 should be 0. Just like the polynomial coefficients. Just like the polynomial coefficients which we did earlier. So just like the polynomial coefficients. Now, yeah, so when you take the derivative here, when you take derivative with respect to u1, this becomes 1 and this becomes 0. Okay, and then plus this becomes 1 and this becomes 0. Minus this becomes 1, this becomes 0. Now BT EB is a symmetric matrix, so it does not matter whether this is at the left or this is at the right. These two terms are actually same. So you remove half, so twice, and take this at the beginning. So this is the first term. 1, 0 transpose this minus. So this is F1 equal to 0. Now what is this? This is actually the first row, because this will be this 1 will be multiplied with the first row and the 0 will be multiplied with the second row. So first row, this is actually the first row of B transpose EB ADX u1 u2 minus f1 equal to 0. And when you take del pi del u2 equal to 0, you get second row of this u1 u2 minus f2 equal to 0. And when you combine this 1 and 2, you get this. So this is the stiffness matrix and this is the force vector. And if you now, you know what is B? B is dn1 dx. B you know that, sorry. Oh my god. So let me stop here. We'll continue a little later. Yeah, so we are here. So as you know that n1 is equal to 1 minus x by l and n2 is equal to x by l. So this b is actually dn1 dx, that means minus 1 by l, and dn2 dx 1 by l. So this is b. Now if you put the value of b here and you multiply and then integrate, you multiply and then integrate, you get this as your stiffness matrix, which is same as what we got from first principles. Now we'll find out the stiffness matrix of a beam element, and you know this is the beam element. And this beam element has got 4 degrees of freedom. So W1, theta1, and W2 and theta2. That is been that means transverse displacement, rotation, transverse displacement, rotation. So just a minute. Okay.
ऑर्डिनरी बाउंड को मैं बोल दिया
Yes, now let us continue. So now here the transverse displacement W at any point within the element at a distance x from the left end is WEX, and WEX is expressed as a polynomial, and these are the undetermined coefficients. But in Rayleigh-Riesz, we keep them as it is, but in finite element, what we do, we replace this coefficients in terms of the nodal displacements. That means in this case it is W1 theta 1, W2 theta 2, and Q is the distributed load which is applied on this beam. Now just use the conditions that x equal to 0, WE equal to W1. That means this A0 will be equal to W1. At x equal to 0, dWEdx equal to theta 1. So at x equal, so you just take derivative of this A1 plus A2x plus 3A3x square, put x equal to 0, and you get dWEdx as theta 1. So A1 as theta 1. So in this way, put WE equal to W2 at x equal to L, and you get this equation, and at x equal to L, dWEdx equal to theta 2. So this is equal to theta 2. In this way, you get four equations, and if you solve for these four undetermined coefficients, you can write WE like this, where N1, N2, N3, N4 are this. So if you plot N1, then N1 is 1 here with a slope 0, and that means dN1dx equal to 0 at x equal to 0, and N1 is 1 at x equal to 0, and dN1dx at x equal to L is 0, so the slope is 0 here, and N1 at x equal to L is also 0. That means the value of N1 is also 0 here. Similarly, if you plot N2 goes with theta 1. So N2 dN2 dx is 1 here. So this is the slope, and the value of N2 at x equal to 0 is 0, and dN2 dx is 1. So it has got a slope of 45 degree. And here, both the value and the slope, they are 0. N3 is value equal to 0, slope equal to 0 at x equal to 0, value equal to 1, slope equal to 0 at x equal to L. And N4, slope 0, value 0 at x equal to 0, and slope 45 degree and value 0 at x equal to L. So now you can write your WE as this, and this is called the shape function matrix. As you know, this is the shape function matrix, and this is the displacements, nodal displacements. Now what is the potential energy then? EI by 2, which we have already seen, d2 WE dx2 square dx plus Q WE dx. So Q means the load, and W means the displacement integrated over the whole length of the beam. It is plus, it should be minus potential of load, but it is becoming plus because WE is positive in this direction, and we have taken Q positive in the downward direction, or in the other direction of WE. That's why this is plus. This is as usual negative. That is W1 into F1, theta 1 M1, W2 F2, theta 2 M2. So this is the potential of load due to the nodal displacements and loads. Now dwe dx, d2we dx2, this is the curvature for small displacement. If you write the general equation for curvature and you make change in the denomination, because d2we dx2 is very small, or dwe dx, or the slope is very small, then you get, you are left with only this term. So from here, it is this. This we call the B matrix. Here it is the curvature displacement matrix. Curvature, here we, curvature is the strain equivalent term. So if you write the potential energy expression now, just like before, so this will get, so when you, are just doing this into d2we dx2, for the first one, you are taking this transpose, that means the transpose of this whole thing, that means this transpose into this transpose, and for the second one, this into this. Now EI you can place anywhere because it is a scalar. So this term, this nodal displacements, can be taken out of the integral, and this part is actually the stiffness matrix of the beam element. And in the right, and so this is pi. So the element equations, if you just, do this, del pi cap del w1 equal to 0, then del pi cap del theta 1 equal to 0, del pi cap del w2 equal to 0, del pi cap del theta 2 equal to 0, then you get the element equations like this, where this is due to the nodal forces and this is due to the distributed load. So this is called nodal equivalent force moments, or sorry, this is called the equivalent nodal forces and moments. With the sign. So it should be with the sign. This is called the, that means this is the distributed load, and this, and this term actually distributes the distributed load as concentrated forces and moments at the nodes. That means this will distribute the distributed load Q on the, as concentrated force and moments at the nodes. Okay, so now if you do this, you will get the stiffness matrix. So this is a matrix multiplication of this, and if you multiply, so this is what you get for KE. And just one term we have, shown here. So this is d2n1 dx2 whole square dx. So if you integrate, n1 is this, so d2n1 dx2 is this. Now if you integrate this, you get k11 as 12 ei by lq. Now if you do this integration for all the terms, you get this as your stiffness matrix, which is same as what we got from first principles. Now what is nodal equivalent nodes? As I showed in the basic equation, this term is actually the nodal equivalent loads. Now if you see, n is 1 into 4, that is 1 row 4 columns, so n transpose is 4 into 1, and this is a single scalar, so this matrix is again a matrix with 4 rows. That means the Q distributed load is now divided in 4 divided in four terms. The first one is the nodal equivalent force, then the nodal equivalent moment at node 1, then nodal equivalent force and nodal equivalent moment at node 2. So this get distributed like this. So how it happens, let us see for one example, suppose Q is a uniformly distributed load. So this is the nodal equivalent load. Now, so transpose means this. So Q is constant, so it can be taken out of the integral. Now, if you integrate, this becomes QL by 2 minus QL square by 12 minus QL by 2 QL square by 12. Or please check the integrations. Here, integrations before a vector means all the elements of this vector, of this row vector, will get integrated. So dx is here and integration symbol is here. So if you integrate this, then it will give you, it gives you L by 2. That means for the forced part, this Q multiplied by L into 2 here in the downward direction. So minus QL by 2 and QL by 2 in here, minus here in the third term, that is the force term, QL by 2 here. This is okay, but the moment you will not understand just by observing this equation. Only QL square by 12 and QL square by 12, they are opposite in sign. So if this is the uniformly distributed load, R1 is minus QL by 2 and R2 is minus QL square by 12, R3 is minus QL by 2 and R4 is QL square by 12. That means this is how the distributed load like this is getting distributed as forces and moments. This is nodal equivalent loads. Now, example 2. So suppose a concentrated load at the midspan. So what are the nodal equivalent loads, nodal equivalent forces and moments? So concentrated force. So first we have to take this concentrated force as a distributed force. So suppose we approximate this concentrated force by a rectangular load of height P by delta and width delta. So the total load is P. But instead of doing this, the better way of doing this is to take a Dirac delta function. You know the Dirac delta function, the area under the Dirac delta function is always 1. So if we take P into the Dirac delta function, that area under is always P. That means we are just making this delta smaller from this side and smaller from this side and going high and high, so that the area remains 1 and we are getting something like this. And one, so we are approximating this load, we are approximating the concentrated load by, not approximating, we are replacing this concentrated load by this Dirac delta function at L by 2 multiplied by P. So another property of this Dirac delta function is, if you multiply a function fx with this Dirac delta function like this, it simply gives you f at the value of function at x equal to L by 2. Now if you have, so nodal equivalent load in this case is, as usual, n transpose this. So n transpose this means n1 this, n2 this, n3 this, n4 this. So P is constant and n1 is a function of x. When integrated with this Dirac delta function, it is simply the value of n1 at x equal to L by 2. Simply value of n2 at x equal to L by 2, value of n3 at x equal to L by 2, value of n4 at x L by 2. And when you find out the values, you get minus P by 2, that is here it is, minus P by 2, here it is, minus P by 2, and here it is minus PL by 8, and here it is PL by 8. So you please check these calculations and see whether these results, which are shown here, are correct or not. So this is the nodal equivalent forces and moments, or simply nodal equivalent forces or nodal equivalent loads. So let me stop here. In the next video, we will see what is a frame element and how we can analyze portal frames, 2D, two-dimensional portal frames, using this frame element. Frame element is nothing but a simple extension of this beam element. Thanks.